This video will show another example of a titration which involves redox, and it's one which also has a few other nuances in it which are good for us to review. So the situation is that you're using a 0.1143 mole per liter potassium permanganate solution to determine the percentage by mass of an aqueous solution of hydrogen peroxide again. You prepare the solution by adding 1.423 grams of the hydrogen peroxide solution to an Erlenmeyer flask. You add about 75 mL of water to dilute the solution. You also add some dilute sulfuric acid to acidify the solution. You reach the light purple colored endpoint of the titration when you have added 40.22 mL of the potassium permanganate solution. What is the percent by mass of the peroxide solution? Let's start with digging through this question and finding out some of the oddities, perhaps, or the things that are maybe not usual in some of our titration examples. So first of all, you have a 0.1143 mole per liter solution of potassium permanganate. Just a quick note that that would be something that you probably standardized already. Potassium permanganate is not a standard solution by itself. Its concentration can change, so you might have standardized it with something like sodium hydroxide to find out its concentration in a separate titration. Now you're trying to determine the percentage by mass, so that's just another way, of course, of denoting concentration, that instead of moles per liter, it's going to be a percent by mass. And the thing you are trying to find the percent or the concentration of is this aqueous solution of hydrogen peroxide. So it's an aqueous solution. It's some hydrogen peroxide dissolved in water. Okay, so you prepare the solution, meaning the solution that you are going to use as your sample, by adding 1.423 grams of the original hydrogen peroxide solution to an Erlenmeyer flask. So let's say this is your Erlenmeyer flask over here. Let's just kind of keep track of what we have in there. So we've got now 1.423 grams of this H2O2 solution. So it's an aqueous solution of hydrogen peroxide. You add about 75 mils. You might be wondering to yourself, since when do we add about 75 mils, just add random amounts of water to our sample? How are we ever going to know the concentration precisely if we don't even know the volume precisely? It just seems like we're randomly diluting this. As if that wasn't enough, you add some dilute sulfuric acid to acidify the solution. So you grab a flask and you dump a little bit in. So how can we accurately know the concentration of our original if we don't accurately know what we're adding to it in this sample? And the key is in units here. So our hydrogen peroxide is measured in grams. This is actually a gravimetric stoichiometry problem. The question we're asked to find out is really what percentage of this original hydrogen peroxide solution, which included some peroxide and some water, what percentage of that is actually hydrogen peroxide? And so it doesn't matter that we've diluted it with water and that we've added some sulfuric acid, because the actual amount of pure hydrogen peroxide that's in there hasn't changed. And that's still the stuff that hopefully is going to be involved in our reaction. So really, with all the random stuff we've added, we're still hoping that hydrogen peroxide is going to be one of the reacting agents, either the strongest oxidizing or the strongest reducing agent, and of course that it's going to get used all the way up. So let's again start with this from a redox perspective by listing all the species we have present and determining what will react. So we know in our flask we're starting with hydrogen peroxide. We know that that's an aqueous solution, so there's also some water present with it. Not only that, but we've added extra water. And then we added some dilute sulfuric acid, which was presumably to acidify the solution, probably because we're going to need those H+ ions to react with one of our strongest oxidizing and reducing agents. So that should give us a hint as to what we expect to be our strongest oxidizing and reducing agents later on. The H+ ions, of course, come with sulfate anions, and that should capture what's in our flask, our sample, to start off with. And then, of course, we're adding potassium permanganate, so that's going to give us K+ ions and the permanganate anion. So that should be a pretty good picture of all of our species present as this is reacting. And now we have to decide which of these are actually going to be the ones that react. And we know that that's going to be the strongest oxidizing agent and the strongest reducing agent. So without identifying all of them, we can see right away that the permanganate anion with the acid is very close to the top of our redox table. So there can be nothing else above it. We can scan the list, but there's nothing else stronger than that. So that together will act as our strongest oxidizing agent. And then also by examining our table of half reactions, we see that hydrogen peroxide will be the strongest reducing agent. There are no other species listed underneath hydrogen peroxide of our reducing agents. Once again, this makes sense because this shows that we have the hydrogen peroxide reacting. It shows that we have the permanganate reacting. And it also gave us a reason why we had to acidify this thing, because the acid was required as part of our strongest oxidizing agent. So copying those equations down directly, I'm just going to quickly show them. And there we see our two half reactions. Once again, to combine these, we have to balance the loss and gain of electrons. So we have 5 electrons and 2 electrons, which is going to mean our reduction reaction is going to have to be multiplied by 2, and our oxidation reaction multiplied by 5. Now you can go ahead and combine and cancel out anything that exists as both a reactant and a product. So we start with 2 permanganates. We're going to have 16 H pluses from this reaction, but of course on the product side we have also 10 from the other reaction, so that leaves us with 6 H pluses, and then of course our 5 hydrogen peroxides. Quick note that the hydrogen peroxide in the data booklet is listed as a liquid, and I used it as a liquid in the half reaction. I'm still writing aqueous in my complete reaction because technically it's only the pure liquid that is reacting, but it is still existing in water, so I can write it as being aqueous in my reaction. So the products of this reaction should be 2 manganese cations, 8 waters, 5 oxygens, and all the rest. So the hydrogen's already canceled and all of the electrons should be canceled. So this should be our balanced chemical equation. Once again, at this point, it turns into normal stoichiometry, except it is gravimetric stoichiometry, so keep that in mind with the variables that we are given and that we're trying to find out. So we're told that the permanganate has a concentration of 0.01143 moles per liter, and we have 40.22 mils of it. And then what piece of information are we trying to find out of this stoichiometry? Well, really what we want to find is how much pure liquid hydrogen peroxide did we have? And by how much, it's actually a mass that we're looking for. So how many grams of pure liquid hydrogen peroxide were kind of hidden in the 1.423 grams of solution that we had? So once again, the 1.423 grams is an aqueous solution. That's some pure peroxide and some water. What we're trying to figure out is how much pure peroxide there was, and later we will use that to find the percent by mass of the solution that it was. So let's go ahead and do our normal stoichiometry calculation. I'll convert it to liters this time for simplicity. So we have 0.04022 liters of the permanganate. The concentration of that was 0.01143 moles per liter. Again, both of those are permanganate. Our mole ratio is that we have 2 moles of permanganate for every 5 moles of peroxide. And if we at this point do a quick survey of our units, we've got liters of permanganate cancels with liters of permanganate. We've got moles of permanganate cancels with moles of permanganate. We've now got moles of peroxide, but we are looking for grams. So of course, the conversion from moles to grams is going to be our grams per mole. So we are wondering how many grams of hydrogen peroxide are in every mole of hydrogen peroxide. So if you look that up, you should find 34.02 as the molar mass. Now, our moles of hydrogen peroxide cancels, and we are left with grams of hydrogen peroxide, which is exactly what we wanted. So once again, if you plug that calculation through, you should get 0.039, 0.09 grams of hydrogen peroxide. So I'm just going to paraphrase what that means. So in our solution, in 1.423 grams specifically of our H2O2 solution, there were 0.03909 grams of pure H2O2. So the way the stoichiometry works is it allows us to calculate how much of this stuff actually reacted. And we know we reacted all of it because we reached the end point. So 0.03909 grams is all there was to react, even though we put in 1.423 grams. So the rest must have been just water. And that's how we find out our percent by mass of our solution. So of course, to find out the percent, we know that there was 0.03909 grams of solute in a total of 1.423 grams of solution. And that's that was our formula for finding percent by mass. So that tells us that there is 2.748% by mass of hydrogen peroxide in our initial solution. We do need that many significant digits, so we won't round any further than that. That's why it is important to keep enough digits in the work until now, or to keep as many digits as possible in your calculator. So hopefully this not only emphasizes how to use redox within stoichiometry, but also refreshes on a few of the other perhaps more subtle concepts of titrations.